Hello and welcome to Veterans Remember, where we have the opportunity to talk with Hopkinton veterans, young and old, who have served our country in wartime and in peace. The service and experience of our Hopkinton veterans have formed the foundation of our country, and the veterans on this program are here to share with us their stories. These chronicles, the Veterans Remember program, are broadcast on HCAM TV and are also made available in our schools and libraries for all to watch and listen to. Now join us for this time with Hopkinton veterans who have served so proudly over the years. I'm your host, Dick Gooding, and joining me today is Paul Annunziata. Paul is a personal friend of mine. We grew up together in Hopkinton, and he's got some interesting stories he wants to share with us. So, Paul, why don't you tell us a little bit about your early years before you went into the service, and then we'd love to hear some service stories.
Okay. First off, I want to say I'm very thankful that you chose me, and I'm honored to be here, Dick.
Well, it's our pleasure, certainly.
My name is Paul Ralph Annunziata. I am the son of Dr. Joe Annunziata and Rita V. Annunziata, and the brother of the late attorney Joseph F. Annunziata, Jr. I basically was born in Framingham, and 2 days later, out of the hospital, came to Hopkinton, so I really had a short stay out of Hopkinton. I stayed in Hopkinton and grew up here, graduated from Hopkinton High School in 1966, and I joined the Army in February 12, 1967. The reason I joined the Army is I really wasn't ready to continue my education at that time. I wanted a little experience to be out on my own. I wanted to travel, be a little more disciplined. So I chose joining the service. And I chose the United States Army because I was down in Framingham and went to the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, the Coast Guard, and I couldn't leave for 3 days. And it was a big decision, and once I made it, I didn't want to have any ill feelings about it. And the Army took me, and I left the next day. So there was no really thinking about it. I went to Fort Jackson, South Carolina, to take basic training. I was in Company C-72. I moved on to Fort Gordon, Georgia, to military police school. I was in Company D-11-4 for a couple of days. When I was nominated for the Infantry 3rd Training Brigade Leadership Training School.
Still for the MPs.
Yeah, but this is a leadership training school because if you were of such a caliber, they wanted you to go to Officers Candidate School, which was OCS.
Sure.
So this was a little preliminary school to get you going in that. I completed that, and I completed my training as a military policeman. I came down on for stateside duty in the 60th Artillery Battalion. I was a military policeman for Nike Herc Missiles. I was a base in Indiana. I stayed there for about 4 or 5 months when I came down on levy for Tejon Korea, the 110th MP Company, which was a weapons ammunition depot in Tejon, Korea. And I stayed there for almost 19 months and got an early drop because of the extension, and then came home.
So, now, why'd you leave the service? Did you give any thoughts to extending your time in the service?
It was a hard thing to do because they wanted to promote me to Sergeant E6. And in the military police, the rank was very hard to get past Specialist E4. And being a sergeant E5, E6 was sort of looming over my head. They wanted to give me a variable reenlistment bonus of $4,200, $4,200, for another like 3 years. So that was a pretty good deal. But I figured if I stayed the next 3 years, then I would be in for life.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to go home.
You wanted to go home.
I wanted to go back to Hopkinton.
Back to Hopkinton. Well, we're certainly glad you came back to Hopkinton. I'm sure that, Paul, that you have some stories. I know you do. And,
yeah.
You know, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you to share some of those stories with us, and maybe you can go right all the way back to basic and tell us a little bit about some of those tales.
I'd enjoy telling you. When I went into the service, a friend of mine's father told me to either buy an iron or get some barber clippers that you could buy in the PX, the little Oster kit that had all the different attachments. And he said, get into barbering, you know, you could make a little extra money, or somebody needs a shirt pressed, your civilian clothes. And of course, he meant later on too with the iron, like once an AIT or once you actually get to your company, somebody would always want a pair of pants pressed, whatever. So it's pretty easy the first 4 weeks of giving somebody a haircut, because there's no attachment. You just whitewall them right down to almost the scalp. Anybody can do it. So I set up a little barbershop in the latrine on the trash barrel. I got my pillow and put that on top of the trash can cover. I took a sheet and I had that. But one thing I did do was I bought a very expensive aftershave lotion, so like Royal Copenhagen. So they smell good, because I knew the barber didn't have that. The barber liked to drink. He liked his tea. I had gone to him a couple times to get a haircut. So everybody knew after 9 o'clock to come in the latrine. I charged 25 cents. I had a little donation cup on the shelf, and people would give me more than that because they loved the aftershave lotion. Everybody smelled the same. So what happened was, in about the 6 week, you could blend it where they let your hair grow a little longer. Well, I sort of had a few beers that night, and I'm doing this guy's haircut, and I messed it up pretty bad. So in formation the next morning, the drill instructor of our platoon came down, and he said, geez, that, he looked at the person I had messed up, and he said, come on with me, we're going up to that barber. You know, that Don Barber, he's been drinking again. And so he's up there. Now, you can't hear a pin drop because this is reveille. He's cursing and swearing and banging on the barbershop door because the barber slept upstairs. He came down and he's, all of a sudden there's a conversation and me swearing at, all of a sudden you couldn't hear a pin drop, dead silence. The two of them came back down to the formation, to our platoon. The person that I messed his hair up got into formation where he was. And the black sergeant, there was a DI, he was very intimidating, but I liked him. He came right up to me and he put his nose right on my nose. And he said to me, your barbering days are over. Get rid of them clippers. And I threw them in the trash. That was the end of the barber.
So that was your first experience as an entrepreneur.
That was my first experience as an entrepreneur in the Army.
Well, that's a real interesting story. How about some more? I'm sure you've got some other stories you can share with us.
We didn't want KP. I befriended this kid, James Ginelli. He was drafted. He didn't want to be in the Army. And I come up with this plan to get out of KP and go over to the mess hall and talk to the cook. And I said, you're doing too much work. I'm a short order cook from Massachusetts, which of course was a tall tale. And I said, and my friend Ginelli, he's a short order cook from New Jersey. He'll help you in the kitchen, and I can do the French toast and the pancakes and eggs, and you know, you can cut down on your work. So he goes, there's got to be something behind this. What's the deal? I said, we don't want any KP, no grease trap, no nothing. He goes, okay. So I'm out there, and the people are coming in, and I'm behind the grill, and they're all looking at me like, how did he get that job? He's cooking, you know, and I'm giving how much French toast. All of a sudden, I hear this big blowout in the back in the kitchen where Ginelli is, and that the cook comes out, and he, big guy from Tennessee or wherever he lived, he's a southern boy. He picked me right up off the ground, and he goes, he swore at me, and he drags me into the back where Ginelli is. Ginelli's sitting there, and there's a pallet with stacks and stacks of eggs. Of course, the crates in the Army, they're this big, right. There's Ginelli, and he says, short order cook, my blank. Look at him, he's broke out with hives. I gotta call the infirmary now and get an ambulance. He was allergic to eggs.
Oh boy.
We had KP every day till we get out of basic training, cleaning the grease trap, everything, pots, pans, you name it. And Ginelli goes, That's one time that backfired.
Jeez.
So well, that was that story.
I don't know how you get into all these stories, Paul.
They're
you know,
true.
I know they are. How about Korea? I know you spent a fair amount of time in Korea. Do you have some stories from your experience in Korea?
Korea was good. They had three gates, the MPs. They had the front gate, an intermediate gate, and an MSA gate that I worked, maximum security area. And they had a sally port, they called it a sally port, which was an area where they could truck in the missiles, the warheads. And they also had a pedestrian walkway, and it was all covered in. Once I went out and pulled the pin so they could open the gate and get in and shut the gate and repin it, there was no way to get out of there. Then we had a gate shack that you walked up to. And this day before that, I had become friends with the first sergeant. We had a little tiff at the NCO club, and then we became very good friends. And he said, Paul, if you come down to the orderly room every Tuesday and Thursday, I'm getting out of the service. I've been in for 30 some odd years. I will teach you every trick that I know. And he did. He was a wonderful man from San Diego, California, Sergeant John Belcher. I never forgot him. He was like an uncle to me. And he taught me use of PAC, 8th United States Army, and everything. So he always taught me that when somebody hands you a people's pass, which is issued by the military police provost marshal, to check the signature of also the commanding general of the post. And I had a little signature card. So when this person came up, he had already penetrated the main gate and the intermediate gate, and he got to my gate, and he put the pass up. Well, the Taegu Field Office, which is tied to the criminal CID, Criminal Investigation Division, and sort of the branch of the CIA of the Army, they were doing a break-in to see if they could penetrate this special weapons dump that they didn't want anybody in there, obviously. So anyway, he came up and he put the pass up, and I don't know why, but Belcher was sticking in my mind, and I pulled out the drawer and I compared the signature and I said, this is a forgery. This isn't the commander general's signature. I know it's a forgery. Now, I tell the MP that's with me in code, did you get the cookies from your mother the other day, which is telling him that this individual is trouble. To go outside, pull your 45 out, jack around in the chamber, and he's going to look through the fence at his profile because he's talking to me inside the shack. Anyway, there's a sabotage alert button down below. He can't see below me. I take his ID card and I dropped it on the floor on purpose. I bent down, hit the sabotage alert button, which goes all through 8th United States Army. I mean, when you hit this button, you better know what you're doing or you're going to go to Leavenworth for a few years because this is big time stuff. And when you hit that, that means that the place is in trouble. So I hit it, I pulled my 45 out, I jacked around in the chamber, and I set it right on the counter in his face. And he started sweating, turning red, and he says, I'm from the Taegu. I says, I don't care where you're from. Shut your mouth and do what I tell you. Put your hands on top of your head. And I looked over to Nixon. I says, you got them covered? Yep. So I went out and I got Nixon's handcuffs. I took my handcuffs. I made the guy, he didn't want to. I said, get your shirt off, get your pants off, your shoes, strip him right down to his skivvies, his underwear. Handcuffed him, spread eagle to the fence. Of course, in the lieu of that, the company commander is coming, the commanding general of the post, sabotage alert, F-4 Phantoms from Osan Air Force Base, and the general got down there with a cigar, and he knew me, called me Ammo. He says, Ammo, what's going on? He says, he tried to break in the place, can you imagine? And the guy says, he was going to shoot me, he's got a round jacked in the chamber. He says, never mind that. He says, this is terrific. I've never seen anything like this in 30 years. So, you know, and here's the guy spread up. But I received a beautiful letter of commendation in my 201 file, and they were going to try to send me to Seoul to go before the E4 board.
Is that right? Now, that guy had gotten through the first two layers before he gotten to you?
It was very sad because the two MPs were a friend of mine. They broke their rank. You can't have it. They shouldn't have not even got in the front gate.
Now, what type of ammunition did they have in this?
It was nuclear weapons.
They had nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
Okay.
They weren't.
I served in Europe, in Germany, in the late 60s before I went to Vietnam.
Yeah.
And we had nuclear warheads over there. And I know the opportunity to we never had anything quite as substantial as you're talking about.
Yeah.
But boy, the rules and regs to get that in were rather significant. But
they kept them in the side of a mountain. They were called igloos, and it was all carved out. And they had big, I'd say, 6-foot concrete doors with steel, a foot of steel as a casing, a framework around it. And they, one time I had the privilege of going up there and seeing one in the actual nuclear warhead.
Yeah.
I wasn't supposed to, but a friend of mine was a warrant officer, and I had to, he's a good friend of mine. I wanted to see it just from an educational standpoint.
The viewing public who's listening to this are probably scared to death thinking of guys like you and me holding control over nuclear warheads, but at least in the where I was, they had a sophisticated locking device, and it was called PAL, Prescribed Action Link, which received numbers directly from the president, which then would be offset on an authentication card, so that even if that guy had broken in, he probably would not have been able to gain access, other than to cause some damage, but he would not have been able to arm a nuclear warhead.
Right.
So, but it's
I think that they're looking at it more so not that one would be set off, just to have maybe photographs and intelligent data about what was there.
Right.
This is a pretty top secret place.
Sure.
So,
Absolutely.
Just somebody coming in and taking photographs was a little bit too much.
Yeah. Well, Korea certainly is a hotbed today and has been a hotbed ever since the Korean War back in the early 50s. Do you have any other stories from your time in Korea?
Yeah. when they come in the maximum security area, you have to give them the two-man rule. No single individual can ever be allowed, whether it's a worker that works there, an MP or whatever, into a maximum security area because of obvious reasons. He has to be watched and counter-watched and looked after if something happened to him, a medical problem or whatever. So I had to give this two-man rule. I pretty much wiped it out of my head since 1968. But it says that no single individual shall enter a maximum security area, no photographic equipment, flame-producing items, and blah, blah, blah. I forget the rest of it. And I had to salute this general and give him the two-man rule, which I gave to everybody that came in there. And so he was smoking a cigar, and he was a brigadier general. And he didn't want to, and he had colonels with him and warrant officers and a whole entourage. He didn't want to put the cigar out. So I said to him, I said, sir, I'm going to ask you one more time. I want you to extinguish the cigar or you're not going in the maximum security area. And he kind of rebuffed me, and I'm a general. Who do you think you are and all this? I said, I'll tell you who I think I am. I have the authority of the commanding general of this post. And this is my post, and you're not going in here. How's that? So he says, I want to use the phone. I says, fine, I'll let you use the phone. Put the cigar out. So he threw it down on the ground. He stomped on it. And he called the commanding general. And he gets on the phone, this and that. So he goes, give me the phone. So he goes, Ammo, what's going on down there? I said, well, Brigadier General George P. Holm, he don't want to put out the cigar. And I told him what the two-man rule is and what you taught me. And he's going to go along with it or he isn't getting in here. And, of course, he told him, you do what he says. So finally, of course, the cigar at that point was destroyed. Off he went. But he never forgot the name Annunziata because he was looking right at it.
He was looking at it, that's for sure.
And then to tell your story quickly.
Sure.
After the break-in or the tried to break-in, that I foiled. I went to the orderly room and he says, here's the train tickets to go to Seoul, to go before the E4 board, Specialist E4. And I said, oh, that's nice, train tickets. It was Lieutenant Gibson was my commanding officer. I pushed the tickets back to him. I said, I'm gonna tell you something, and you're not gonna like it, but I'm gonna tell you anyway. I said, I've been in the service for 15 and a half months, PFC grade, no Article 15, no disciplinary action, and I'm one of the straightest, best MPs you got in this post, whether you like that or not. You're gonna give me E4. I'm not going before any E4 board. And when the generals come down, they wanna know why a PFC is on the maximum security area gate running the show that's an E5 slot, you go ahead and tell them. And saluted. I went back 2 days later. I don't know how he did it, and he pushed the envelope back to me, and I said, I told you I don't want those tickets. And he just smiled at me, and he said, open it up and shut up. I opened it up, and there's the E4. So he gave it to me in the orders. So he promoted me. And it wasn't that much longer after I became Sergeant E5, Assistant mm-hmm. Platoon Sergeant, so it was quite a thing. I look back on it that
you were a burr under a lot of people's saddle, weren't you? Well, after you left the service, unless you've got, have you got another story for us? We'd love to hear another story about your service time.
I'm trying to think now. Yes, I do have another one.
I figured that, Paul.
I'm going to go back to the 60th Artillery Battalion mm-hmm. in Indiana. Thanksgiving. They wanted me on the front gate. Now, in Korea, you're in combat military police mm-hmm. Attire, or uniform, I should say. Now, when I'm on the front gate in Indiana, I'm in my dress greens, all my patent leather, you know, really sure. A nice MP, white gloves, a white hat, the whole deal. Well, this car pulled up, an Army car, it was a 65 or 66 Chevrolet. And it pulled up, OD green, and in the back was this colonel. And supposedly, he was the battalion commander, brigade commander, one of them, and Colonel Greer. And so he came up, and I saluted the driver, and the driver said to me, I have Colonel Greer in the back seat. So I made him roll down the window, the colonel. He's in mm-hmm. the back all by himself. So I said, good morning, sir, nice to meet you. I said, I need to see your identification. And he goes, what? I said, I need to see your identification. And he says, I'm Colonel Greer. I'm like the brigade commander, you know. And I said, well, I'll be very honest with you. I've never seen you before, and I don't know who you are. I mean, your name tag says Greer, but that doesn't mean anything. I want to see your military identification. The driver of the car is looking up at the headliner of the car with sweat coming down him, shaking his head, saying, boy, you're all done. You're going to be shipped to Saudi Arabia. So anyway, I felt bad for him. He takes out this expandable thing, and I never forgot it, the Shell gas card, charge cards falling out, pictures of his family. And I'm going, oh man, and they're going all over the seat of the car, medals and everything, and holy medals. And he takes out his military ID, and it's Colonel Greer. And I give it back to him, and I said, I'm sorry, but understand one thing. I've never met you, and a dishonor to you is, and you can break my rank if I'm not telling you the truth. You go in the orderly room, there's no picture of you there. The frame is there, Colonel Greer, but it's blank. You are not there. I guess they didn't think you were important. I said, now you have a nice Thanksgiving. And I saluted. Well, he went in the orderly room, and he raised hold, because there was no photograph of him, so right. I didn't know who he was. So well, he stopped on the way out, and he said, I got to tell you something. Even though you gave me what I thought was a hassle, you're pretty strapped. I'm very proud of you. You have, and shook my hand and wished me happy Thanksgiving, and off he went.
Off he went. Well, Paul, after you left the service, you came back to Hopkins, and then what sort of things did you do?
I came
for a career after military service.
I came back to Hopkinton, and I had a hard choice to do a little bit because I had the experience of the military police. I had also gone to school in Korea, a special security school that I forgot to mention, that only like 20 candidates from Korea went to, and taught you all kinds of things about security and containment. And the other thing was that when I got out, I wanted to go to trade school because I love cars. And I went, and I knew that the GI Bill would pay for the schooling and help me. I went to Jack O'Brien, the principal, the superintendent of Hopkins High School that I knew. He said, Paul, you got to go to California. You'll have good education. And that's what I did. I came back and I opened up a shop in Framingham where I tuned up, dyno-tuned a lot of cars, Plymouth GTXs, Corvettes, all the hypo cars. And then finally ended up in General Motors where I worked for 16 years down in Framingham.
So, well, listen, Paul, we've been fascinated with your stories of your military service. And again, Paul and I go back probably close to 60 years, probably 55 years or so, and knew his father and his brother very well. His brother and I played on the same baseball team, and I have a picture with Paul as our bat boy, because he's a little bit younger than me, but that was quite a picture from the old Little League Red Sox.
Yeah, it was.
And we thank you very much for joining us today. And for those of you who are watching and listening to the stories, thank you very much for joining us today on Veterans Remember. Again, I'm Dick Gooding, your host, and Paul Annunziata has joined us today to tell us some fascinating stories. And Paul is a proud Hopkinton veteran and a longtime resident of the community. Veterans Remember is pleased to have the opportunity to talk with our veterans and hear their stories. And Paul's stories have been just absolutely fascinating. So thank you very much, and have a good day.